I'm Andy Wilson. Welcome to worship with La Crescenta Presbyterian Church. We hope that you'll experience God's peace as you open your heart to Him today. Welcome to La Crescenta Presbyterian Church. We're so thankful that you chose to worship with us this morning. And we just ask that as you get ready to start worship, that you would prepare your heart to be in a place of receiving whatever God has for you this morning.
Again, thank you for being with us.
Take my dry bones, breathe life into this skin. You call me by name, raise me to life again. You can calm the oceans, speak peace into my soul. Take me as I am, in my heart to be again. Oh, oh Jesus. Oh, oh Jesus. Oh, oh Jesus. Alive in me. Set the captives free. As I stand and sing, you're breaking the chains of me. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus.
Our first scripture reading today is from Matthew chapter 14, verses 6 through 12. On Herod's birthday, the daughter of Herodias danced for them and pleased Herod so much that he promised with an oath to give her whatever she asked. Prompted by her mother, she said, "Give me here on a platter the head of John the Baptist." The king was distressed, but because of his oaths and his dinner guests, he ordered that her request be granted and had John beheaded in the prison. His head was brought in on a platter and given to the girl, who carried it to her mother. John's disciples came and took his body and buried it. Then they went and told Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Well, we've come to the point in our service where we'd like to remind you that you can give online through the Shelby Next app or lcpc.net, or if you'd like to give an offering through sending a check to the church office, you can do that as well. We're grateful for your faithful generosity, church. Would you please pray with me? Our God and Father, we come before you admitting, confessing that as you've been a good God to us this week, we have wandered from you. That as you have been a good shepherd who has led the way diligently, who has called out to us and told us where to go, where to lie down, where to eat, and where to drink, that we've instead acted like goats who knew a better way. That we've done what we wanted to do and not what you would have us do. So God, we ask for your forgiveness. We know that you are the only good shepherd, and that when we try to follow our own desires, when we try to follow our own hearts, it only leads us to destruction. But we want the life that you bring. We want the hope of the good shepherd. So God, fill us with humility to follow you wherever you take us. We also, God, we ask you for protection. At a time where it feels like our earth is falling apart in a lot of ways, where it feels like relationships are falling apart, where it feels like, man, we just cannot catch up with all that's going on. We know that you are sovereign, that you're in control, and that you are good. So God, we ask you to intervene. We ask you to bring your goodness to this world. That in broken relationships, in the fires that we're seeing all around us, that you would pour out your spirit, that you would give us grace and mercy. God, we thank you for the firefighters who are fighting these fires right now. We ask that you would keep them safe and protect them, that you would give them wisdom. God, we ask that you would motivate us to give love in areas where maybe we're not comfortable. We ask that you would be our guiding light. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Continuing now in Matthew chapter 14 at verse 13. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place, and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat. We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children. Thanks be to God for his word.
Trouble presents us with opportunities to learn and grow. What's God trying to teach us in this season of trouble? He's bringing us back to the basics. In the midst of the pandemic, the protests, the fires, and the political warfare, he's reminding us who we are and why we're here. God's deepest desire for us is that we would grow in the character of Jesus. His great plan for us is that we would continue the work that Jesus began, the work of building his kingdom and delivering as many people as we possibly can from sin and death. But here's the hard truth we can only learn when the road is rough and it feels like the wheels are about to come off. All growth in the Spirit comes through testing. All progress comes from exercising the right traits of character when things are hard. If we want to become more like Jesus, we have to stand up to temptation. If we want to become kingdom builders, we have to face life's trials with courage. And through it all, we have to trust God to work through the bad stuff, all this bad stuff in our lives, to accomplish his purposes. That's how we make progress as Jesus followers. In the life of the Spirit, again, all growth comes through testing. It's easy to understand that lesson as it relates to physical or mental challenges. We know we're not going to be physically fit if we spend every day staring at a phone or a TV screen, stuffing our face with chips and dip. To get in shape, we have to get moving. We have to sweat and groan. No pain, no gain. We also know we're not going to master a sport or a foreign language or a musical instrument unless we practice. We have to practice habitually, and we have to practice in ways that tax our brains and wear us out. We get all that. What we don't get is how or why we grow through the stuff that really hurts, the stuff that threatens to crush our spirits, like coming down with shingles, or losing a job, or having a spouse walk out on us, or having to shelter at home for months on end with no end in sight, or having a family member die of COVID. How does trauma like that help us to grow? How does the stuff we face in life that's truly awful help to advance God's purposes? We've all been asking those questions since the world went into quarantine. Those two stories that we just read from Matthew can help us. They remind us that the Lord himself faced trials that were deeply discouraging and that forced him to his knees. More than that, they show us how God can use traumatic events to strengthen our faith and advance his perfect plan. Let's take a few minutes to think about the response of Jesus and his followers to deep heartache and to extreme pressure. Then let's think about the deep heartache and pressure we've all experienced lately. How can the Lord help us to overcome discouragement and fear and live into his plan for our lives? The first reading tells the story of John the Baptist's death. King Herod is holding John in prison. Herod's ticked off because John has openly called him out for his sin of stealing and marrying his brother's wife. Herod would love to kill John, but he knows the Baptist has lots of followers. He doesn't want to create more enemies in Galilee. He doesn't want to set off a riot by killing a celebrity prophet. Herod has shown himself to be a cagey ruler of the obstreperous Galileans. But in this instance, he makes a huge mistake. The king's enjoying a birthday party in his honor. The wine's flowing, and the party's kicking into high gear. Herod's stepdaughter, Salome, beguiles him with an erotic dance. Herod rashly tells her he'll give her anything she asks for. At her mother's insistence, the young woman asks for the head of John the Baptist on a platter. Not wanting to appear weak in front of his guests, Herod summons the head guard, who quickly runs to the palace prison, and within the hour, Salome is presented with the Baptist's head. John's disciples are told they can have John's body, After burying the headless corpse, they find Jesus and tell him what has happened. The gruesome news hits Jesus hard. We have to remember, John was the messenger sent by the Father to prepare the way for Jesus. Jesus had said of John, "Among those born of women, there has not risen anyone greater than John the Baptist." Jesus needs to grieve. He needs to pray and think about how John's death will affect God's great plan of salvation. He gets on a boat and he goes to a remote shoreline across the Sea of Galilee. Our second reading describes what happens immediately after John's gruesome execution. It's one of the most familiar stories in the New Testament. Jesus has become a sensation in Galilee. When word of his whereabouts gets out, thousands of people flock to him. Some are sick. Maybe Jesus will heal them, as he has so many others. Many more are bewildered, scared, grief-stricken because of John's death. Maybe Jesus will offer a word of hope. If Jesus is troubled by this sudden tsunami of people, he doesn't show it. Without delay, he starts to receive the sick one by one and to heal them. Many hours later, as the sun is approaching the horizon, the disciples are the ones who become testy. They tell Jesus to send the people away so that they can scrounge for their dinner. But Jesus tells them to feed the crowd. The disciples tell him he's nuts. They don't have enough food for themselves, let alone the crowd of more than 5,000 hungry souls. But Jesus tells them to gather what they can, which, as it turns out, is only 5 loaves and 2 fish. Jesus blesses the tiny meal. Then he instructs the 12 to distribute the food, and when they do so, the bread and the fish are multiplied. Everyone eats their fill, and the disciples collect 12 baskets of leftovers. We learn a lot about the Lord from that familiar miracle. One clear lesson is one that we've talked about before, and that has to do with the involvement of the disciples. In the story, the Lord leans on them to share in his kingdom-building work. More than that, when his disciples step out to do the impossible happens. We'll talk more about that in a minute. But let's not lose sight of the bigger picture. For the followers of John the Baptist, as well as most of the people attracted to Jesus, the outlook is bleak. Everyone involved, Jesus included, has been traumatized by recent events. John is dead. Herod Antipas, Rome's puppet king, has silenced Israel's greatest prophet. It appears that God's purposes have been thwarted and the forces of evil have triumphed. In short, Jesus and most of those gathered around him are feeling scared, angry, discouraged, confused, and just worn out. We have to keep all that in mind as we try to imagine the impact of the healing miracles followed by the feeding of the 5,000. And by the way, the crowd size was really more like 10,000 plus, because only the men were included in the count of 5,000. The crowd, Jesus himself, and the disciples have all been rocked to the core by John's death. Yet they all demonstrate remarkable resilience and strength. The people of Galilee suddenly have another reason to fear their king, the homicidal Herod. Worse than that, many of them are wondering if God has abandoned them. Yet they don't retreat into their houses and give in to despair. Instead, their instinct is to go to Jesus. Jesus himself is emotionally and spiritually just wrung out. He and his Father have a lot to discuss. How will John's death affect Jesus' mission? What if Herod now targets his 12 disciples? Jesus is badly in need of downtown time by the lake. And yet when the noisy, desperate crowd arrives, his instinct is to reach out to them in love. All of the disciples are confused and demoralized by John's death. They also need a break from ministry. They're understandably upset when Jesus tells them to feed the hungry throng. Yet when Jesus tells them to start handing out their tiny ration of food, they don't throw a tantrum and walk away. Their instinct is to trust and obey. We've all been rocked by COVID-19, and then by the riots, and then by the fires. And we can expect another firefight over the presidential election. We all know that's coming. Sadly, our troubles have sometimes brought out the worst in us. Some of us are still paralyzed with fear. We're just as scared as we were 7 months ago when we first learned about the virus. And all we want to do for the next 7 months is hunker down at home and binge watch Netflix. Some of us are angry with God. We've been wrestling with Him for months as we shelter. We're not getting any answers, at least not any that put us at ease. We're wearing out sitting home alone with God, and we're on the verge of throwing in the towel. Some of us are scrambling around trying to keep the world from collapsing. We're combating all the ignorance about COVID, about racism, about Biden or Trump. We're shaming those who aren't cooperating with our movement or cause. We're working like crazy to mobilize the masses, but we feel like we're spinning our wheels. We're all being tested as never before, and we're all struggling to find a way forward. Maybe we should rethink our strategy. Maybe we should look again at those worn-out stories about Jesus and his followers. What would happen if instead of retreating into our hidey hole at home, we turned outward and we sought the company of other Jesus followers? And of course, by the way, we can do that remotely. We've got Zoom. We've got all kinds of technology to help us to do that safely. And then what if together we marched to that lonely shoreline where Jesus is hanging out? We don't know what the Lord might do, but this much we do know for sure. We would see Jesus once again in the faces of our long-lost sisters and brothers. And the Lord would begin to use us again to awaken faith and bring hope and new life to our godless world. All growth in the Spirit comes through testing. But so often what's needed before growth is possible is pruning. In those times, and I think we're living definitely through one of those times, testing is really a process of pruning. It's a messy, painful process where the Lord is cutting out everything that's unhealthy, everything that's unproductive, so that new life can emerge. Of course, we worry that all the pruning will be too severe. We worry that instead of stimulating new life, the pruning will lead to a long, slow death. In those times, we have to remember that it's not up to us to prune. It's not up to us to bring about new growth after the pruning. Our job as Jesus followers is to obey His commandments and trust in His grace and His mercy and power, even when things look bleak. It's to turn outward and give away the tiny portion of food, the tiny blessing that has been entrusted to us, confident that the Lord can and will use it to feed thousands, to multiply the blessing for those around us. Today is Friday, and as we're recording this message, my wife is driving our daughter Holly to LAX. Having spent the last 6 years in an incredibly fruitful ministry with YWAM, Youth with a Mission, Holly's now heading north to Redding to share an apartment with Hannah. She has no job. She has no car. Her bank account is dwindling, but she learned to listen to the Lord, has learned to listen to the Lord through her experiences with YWAM and to trust Him with her future. And she and we are excited. A few nights ago, Holly had a dream. In the dream, I had pruned the long bank of roses in our backyard all the way down to the ground, so there was nothing showing. It looked like I'd killed them. But the next morning, in Holly's dream, Holly went to check on the roses and was delighted to see that they had bloomed. Each rose had produced an abundance of blooms, thus all the size of volleyballs. She interpreted the dream as a sign of God's favor for the next season of her life. I interpreted the dream as a reminder of what God does when trouble strikes. He prunes. We wait, and new life comes. May it be so for you and for your family. May it be so for this church family, LCPC. May it be so for every church that's struggling now to be faithful in this hard season. Lord God, we thank you for your good word to us and for the promise of new life that comes in the midst of struggle and difficulty. God, thank you for those around us who are struggling faithfully with these hard times. God, we pray that in this season of testing, that we would be proven to be faithful and courageous. We pray, God, that in this season, this church family would prove to be a blessing to the community around us. Lord, help us to overcome fear and to put our faith in you and our trust in you. Lord, we do know that you're a living Savior. We know that you have a great promise for this world and for the world on the other side of COVID. And we pray, God, that in the midst of this struggle, in the midst of this time of testing, Lord, that you would be alive in our midst, bringing new life, bringing faith, bringing confidence. And we pray it in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
I know what you're thinking. The third time of seeing me this morning, it's too much. I know. But we're again so thankful that you chose to worship with us this morning. And we want to just give you a quick update in case you haven't seen our outdoor service that takes place in the courtyard on Sunday evenings is now being moved to 5 o'clock. We want to give us just enough time of daylight, and we think it's cooling off a little bit. So 5 o'clock tonight, we would love for you to join us. It's just like 50 minutes in the courtyard for a reflective time of prayer and worship and a sermon. So please come join us at 5 tonight. We'd love to see you. Have a great Sunday, church.